this man's heart was. And God knew what his God was. God knows where every one of your hearts are. And God knows where every one of your gods are. But when we come to God, if we want to really find him, we will learn if there is anything that you love more than God. You cannot serve God and mammon. It's not just being wealthy, but God knows where every one of our hearts and our treasures lay. And if there is something that is more important to him, you cannot serve God and him. I'm reminded of an old blind man, a beggar sitting by the roadside outside of Jericho. He didn't have a dime. He didn't even have 2 cans to recycle in. I don't even know if he had friends, Sister Buena. If he had friends, where were they? This beggar, but he had something that was really powerful, his ears. His ears were very keen and very sharp. One day he heard footsteps. But not just footsteps of one man, but it sounded like footsteps of a crowd, or maybe a parade or something that is coming on the road. There was a crowd of people approaching. Now the footsteps started passing by closer. What does this mean? What's happening? He cried out to anybody who listened to him. What is happening? What's going on? What is all these people doing? Right. There was somebody who was kind enough to say to him, Sister Kathy, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. I don't know what went through that beggar's mind, but he didn't know it was Jesus, Brother Tim. That's why he was asking, what's going on? But somebody said, it's Jesus of Nazareth. And I don't know what went through that beggar's mind, but I'm trying to think. The beggar must have thought, Jesus of Nazareth. I heard of him. That's the one who cares for people. That's the one who heals. I've heard of him. He's and doing miracles. I wonder if you thought, here is my chance. I've not had a chance before. But here is my chance. Here is my one moment. My one chance. Here is my chance. For God gives equal chances and opportunities to all. Here is my chance. And he didn't figure it all out. He just began to cry out. He began to cry out so loud. And he was so desperate that somebody went over to him. Some disciple went over to him. Some church person went over to him and said, shut up, you're making too much noise. But he started screaming, Jesus! Jesus! But that was the only chance. I gotta tell you, we gotta get desperate to realize sometime this might be our only chance to get something together in our mind. This might be the only opportunity, and it might not pass us by twice. What would be time? But he got desperate. He began to say, Jesus! Jesus! And it would have been something if somebody was quieted him down. What if the disciples had the nerve to quiet him down? Shh, quiet! Quiet! I don't think they said, shh, I'm out for the help, you know, little baby. I don't think they said that. He said, hey, quiet, shut up, shh. What's wrong with you? You don't have to yell like that. If your wife will come by you, he'll come by you. You don't have to yell from far. But the blind man realized he ain't got nothing to lose. I may not have another chance, but this is my chance. I'm not going to let this one chance I have slip away. Cried louder, Jesus! Yes. The Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus, something happened. The one who couldn't hear the one on the cross next to him. Jesus felt the desperation welling up in the beggar as he heard his cry. Stop! rabbit. Hey, bring him here. I don't know. I just wonder. I don't know, but I know who tried to quiet the beggar down. Whoever it was that tried to quiet it down, I hope that was the one Jesus told to bring the beggar to him. Jesus had it brought to him, and Jesus stood still and said, what do you wish for me to do for you, sir? What is it that you want me to do for you? And he said, Lord, can I receive my sight? And the Bible says, immediately receive his sight and follow him, glorifying God. He used his chance, people, when he realized that he had an equal shot, just like everybody else. Yes. And he used that one chance he had. Now we might be thinking, I give my life to the Lord next week. You might have a lot of opportunities because of where we are to surrender to him. But there are chances that God affords you every day that can propel you into opportunity that may never pass you again. There are chances, Brother Archie, that God may bring past to you today that might have a rippling effect to set up for something in the future. And if we have a chance, you want your chains broken and falling, there might be a chance today. You might have a chance with something that happens and God begins to start to turn something in your life today. There might be a chance. And Bartimaeus realized that this is my chance. This is my only chance. And I'm not going to let my chance slip through my hands. It could be said of that little woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. 12 long years. Spent all that she had trying to get well. Had all the bank sales and sold all the corn that she could sell, raising money and picked up all the sticks that she could do to pay every doctor, because I gotta think, what is it of a person that would spend everything they have to make them well? What kind of pain and misery was she have been living through that she was willing to set it all to be well? Some of us not even would spend $15 to go see the doctor because we don't want to pay the doctor's bill because we're not that sick. Some of us are so cheap that when we go to mom, we rather buy the $2.99 Equate version instead of the Tylenol version. We're not willing to spend to get well because we're not that sick and we're not that desperate. But what kind of desperation must have gripped her that she sold everything, everything, because she was desperate for healing? And I don't think we can fully visualize or conceptualize how much pain she must have been in, how crippling there must have been, how many setbacks there must have been for her. But one day, she heard of Jesus, and she heard of the things that Jesus could do, and she said, if I can but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. But even touching the hem of her garment, friend, was a big undertaking too. Because she was not a robust woman, she was weak. And pushing through a crowd to get to him was a challenge. You try going to Walmart pushing through the crowd for Black Friday, it ain't that easy. And you try to be frail. You try to be frail trying to push through there. That's why some of us, 50 and over, we send our kids first before us. And we don't go and stand in the line. But just imagine, we can do it, Sister Annette, but it's a dangerous world on Black Friday at Walmart. But imagine this woman in her frailty and in her sickness and being ill and the issue of blood taking a toll on her body, Sister Sabo. It wasn't easy to push through the crowd because it was everybody else wanted to get to the master too, because they heard about that too. But there was something that welled up inside of her that this may be my only chance, and I've got to do what I've got to do. She had been sick for 12 years. I don't think she was standing up like this after 12 years. Some of us, we get a cold and we come in and we look worse than we did the day before. We look worse in front of people than we are without people. We come in and we hold in our back and the cold has nothing to do with our back. Anyway, the cold is sore. lot of irony that we too. And you think they're stupid and this aren't you? But this is her only hope. And she was so determined. This is her chance. This chance might never pass by her way again. This is her chance to serve a God who gives everybody a chance. But you see, just because he gives you a chance, you have to still do what you've got to do to take an opportunity and make the most of it. We sit and we think our chance is going to come to us. No, no, no. It might be passing from afar, but you might recognize that this is your chance and you've got to do something about it. We're lazy. We want God to prove to us. He don't have to prove to you. He don't have to prove to you on that railroad, my dear friend. But this is her only hope. So she thought that somehow she would touch him. I gotta think, she must have thought in her head, how am I ever going to do this? I wonder if she would run through and say, I'm clean. I don't know, so everybody move. I don't know what she was going to do. I got uku, so everybody move out of the line. That's what some of us do. I tell you what, when we like get to a line, you put a I pregnant deal. Old lady, what we do?
Pregnancy on the bus.
You gotta understand that more people than just her gathered to see Jesus. Even the stragglers and the latecomers passed her by. They moved faster than her, Sister Samo. If Jesus was there, the people who were later was running faster than her. Don't you think people were carrying their babies and pushing through and fighting to get their kids healed too? She kept walking slowly, though. She finally got this, Sister Naomi. She was on the edge of the crowd. And I don't really know what happened when she was on the edge of the crowd. I don't know, Brother Archie, if she was too weak, if she was too tired. But she couldn't get her way through. Somehow, she fell to the ground. I don't know how. But somehow she had to get to the ground, Sister Kathy. And I get this picture on the ground like this. You know what I'm going to do? This view looks a lot easier. I don't know exactly how she did it, Brother Tim. She finally got there behind me and eventually her head. It seemed like a miles away, trembling and stretching to reach out. And as she touched the corner of his garment, immediately, the issue of blood was stopped. But I think what was troubling was the words that she heard. Who touched me? It was the master who asked. Who touched him? And I can picture everybody denying. But Master, in this crowd of people, anybody could have touched you. But no. It was a different kind of touch that touched me. Who was it that touched me? Now, I don't know